taping this outdoors, al fresco, for New Millennium Oral History Archives in the World, here in New York City, at one of my favorite locations, Union Square Park. And today we have a wonderful subject that has agreed to come on and talk to us about his life in theater, stage, and on film. Today on Cinco de Mayo, Wednesday, 5 May 2021. His name is James Preston Bates.
Jerome.
I always get your forename, as we say in the UK, right? You've been in the UK. First name, I said James, but it's Jerome.
Jerome
Preston Bates.
Bates.
Right. So we're happy to have you today. So let's start with you and I have spent so much time talking off screen. Yeah.
Exactly.
So as I said earlier, you've been involved in over 300 productions.
I'd say.
Stage, probably 360 to 400. Workshops, stage, film, television, and I don't know, audio?
Audio.
You've even done audio.
Readings of new plays.
Readings, stage readings of plays. In fact, you did a 2-year reading of all of August Wilson, the great August Wilson's plays.
Yes.
That's right, all 10.
All 10 in Augusta, Georgia.
That's right. Yeah. The so-called Pittsburgh Cycle, or the American 20th Century. Cycle, the great August Wilson. So you've done all that. Yeah. So let's start at the beginning, as some would say. So going in
Augusta, Georgia,
and then you mentioned it in another southern city, first, so straight to Newark, New Jersey.
Yeah, Augusta, Georgia. Then I lived in Spartanburg, South Carolina, and then we moved to Columbus, Ohio.
So you made your way to New York. Yeah.
So about 6 months in each place, and then my mom and I came to New York. Stayed about a year. We went to New York. Stayed about a year.
And you were in New York.
Yes. And up until that point, I'm about 6 years old.
So you're seven. And then you went back down south.
Went back to Augusta. Stayed a year.
Grammar school.
Third grade. And then went to Atlanta. From fourth grade to about the 10th grade.
Okay.
And stayed in Atlanta.
And then after that, 10th grade?
And after that, I went back to Augusta, Georgia,
right,
for 11th and 12th grade, and then to Knoxville College and the University of Tennessee, and then eventually to London, London Academy of Music and Dramatic Arts.
Not to be confused with RADA, the Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts in London. Okay, but what we want to back up a bit so we can sort of dig in on some of the chronology that you wonderfully laid out for us. With that great actorly voice of yours.
Okay.
So you started in theater, as I understand it, in secondary school. High school?
In high school.
In high school. Right. And you were part of the Outward Bound program. Upward Bound. Upward Mobility. In the North, we have something equivalent to that. I told you it's called College Bound. In the high school program.
Yeah.
These are people sort of a preparatory program for college.
Yeah.
Or college. Students who are likely to go to college. And you were able to study in the university while in high school.
You did? Yes, at Payne College.
Payne College.
In Augusta, Georgia.
In Augusta.
Yeah.
Right. And was it all in the theater program or the arts program?
No, it was preparing us for just college curriculum. Yeah. And I was just fortunate enough that they had theater. Mm-hmm. You know, I came up out of an athletic background, actually. I ran track. I played football in high school, and so.
Were you good enough to go on in those endeavors professionally?
I felt I was good enough, but we moved around so much.
Right.
But the field will test you.
That's right.
I had some injuries, but you know, being good in that sport, like in anything, you have to be in 8th grade, 9th grade, 10th grade. They build you to a particular point. But we moved around so much, as you can see.
And then you also you were at several colleges before completing, your undergraduate program in
Knoxville, yes.
Tennessee.
Yes. Yeah.
That's University of Tennessee in Knoxville.
And University of Tennessee in Knoxville.
At Knoxville.
Right. Well, actually, it's Knoxville College, and then the University of Tennessee. So I did my freshman, sophomore, junior year by the time my senior year, I was taking courses at the University of Tennessee, which completed my undergrad program.
Did you have any mentors in the arts during that period?
During that period of time.
Leading up to the time you were in college and secondary school?
Yes, I would think, I would say Linda Paris Bailey, the Carpetbag Theater. She still runs the Carpetbag Theater in Knoxville, Tennessee, incredible, over 47 years. I would definitely would name her.
Is it a black theater company?
It's a black theater company out of Knoxville.
You think because it's called Carpetbag, or Carpetbag Theater, it would be, well, I guess the Carpetbag is went down there.
Right.
That's where the term comes from.
Right.
The South and Development South.
Yes. It was started by a gentleman, Mr. Lucas,
who was
from New York. And Linda was a graduate of Howard. And she came down to Knoxville. She started a theater program. So that was it. I think in Oakwood Bound and Payne College, a woman that I've never seen again by the name of Miss Turner really inspired me a lot. Really inspired me, supporting her wing. But after that, I never knew her. And another, I never got a chance to meet her again. And another gentleman, Les Roberts, who eventually came to New York and was in the River Niger on Broadway with Douglas Turner Ward. And he directed me in First Militant Minister. And
by the way, that particular play, I always think about the River Niger. Lynn Turman was in it, in the film version. Now, did it go some, was that production before it went to Broadway, was it at Negro Ensemble Company?
It was, yeah.
Uh-huh.
And then it moved to Broadway.
Then it moved, how long did it stay on Broadway, by the way?
That's a good question. I was in college at the time.
Right.
I think maybe they were good to do a year, if, you know.
Right.
And, yes, it would be considered off-Broadway theater, or the Theater Universal Images in downtown Newark, New Jersey, at Symphony Hall, Clarence Lilly being the artistic director. I'm walking around, on my lunch break from Bamberger's working downtown Newark, saw this sign saying actors, and I walked in, and he said, we're already in production of a play, but you can be an understudy if you like. I said, yeah, put me down as an understudy. So I understudied Richard Wesley's Sirens as the role of Bobby, and that was pretty much the first thing I did once I came out of college. And then from there,
That was completely fortuitous accident.
It's amazing.
Yeah,
and Richard Wesley is so incredible. We'll get to the Richard Wesley segment as well, but I got a chance to really create one of his roles in one of his plays as well, also. But from there, I used to look into the show business and backstage and trying to get into New York.
Two trade papers that no longer exist.
Yeah, no longer exist, yeah. And at the one time, that was like, you know, the Ministry of Theater, where we can, you know, find out what to do where.
Right.
I remember a group, Titus Walker. He had the Ujamaa Theater. You remember that?
Yeah. That was in the 50s on the West Side.
Yes.
Near
yes.
What today is near Martin Luther King
that's
High School.
Right across the street. Yeah.
Near Lincoln Center.
Yes, that's
and
right.
And he always used to have those commercials on.
Yes, that's right. I was a part of his company in 79, 80, probably 81. And right across the street from Martin Luther King High. He worked out of a center there.
Like, what did that happen to that? I was asking some theater folk. What happened to that, to his company?
Well, you know, he died. I don't know if you knew he passed.
I imagine
about,
he did.
About 10 years ago. His son has picked it up now. And I understand they're still doing plays. They're still doing things.
Yeah.
They're not there. You know, we used to always rent theater spaces throughout the city. So I understand that his son is still doing work.
Okay,
that's
around
the city.
That's good to know.
Yeah.
What was his son? Is it Titus Walker Jr.?
I think so, yes. Titus Walker Jr.
And then Umaja, and he's doing out there
with Umaja. Theater Company.
That's
yeah.
Right.
Kind of homage to his father.
Right.
He wrote so many incredible plays. But just gave him an opportunity to step out on stage. And he would rent theaters around the Broadway area. He rented the Carter Hotel, which is now where a big
3rd Street is. New York Times building.
Yes, right across the street from it.
43rd between 7th and 8th Avenue in Broadway.
Yes, and there was a theater in there. He would rent that theater, and you would come in, you would get trained, you would be in one of his plays, and all of a sudden you could tell your mom that, hey, Mom, I'm on Broadway.
You were close to Broadway. We just like
you were in the Broadway area.
Because it's technically 7th and 8th Avenue.
Yeah. Or you could say, I'm in the Broadway area.
That's right.
And
you were.
Yeah, and you were. And so, you know, I, from there,
I just wanted to say, pardon me, those opportunities don't exist anymore. I was looking around a few years ago for who's renting and staging productions. You even had some of these productions that weren't of a high caliber, but they used to tour. We used to call them, they were sort of sitcom-ish kind of production that these black producers would stage. It would be big. It would be like watching a sitcom. I'm telling you, you probably knew some of them.
Yeah, yeah.
You know.
I think they came a little later, like the late 80s and the 90s. What was his name? He was pre-Tyler Perry.
That's right.
I forgot his name, but he had a few things like Barbershop, Shop.
That's right.
Things like
that.
But
then Tyler came afterward, and Tyler just hit it out of the park.
Yes.
And now, has a big film studio, much else.
Mega billionaire going on. Incredible. Movie studio right there in Georgia.
Very productive. So you mentioned that Bamberger's doesn't even exist there anymore.
Bamberger's was a
department store?
Yeah, the department store. Macy's bought it, and then eventually it was.
Unbelievable. Yeah. So from New Jersey to New York, you also mentioned you were at the Circle, not the Circle Rep. Is it the Circle Rep?
We eventually got to the Circle Rep around in the 90s.
Great off-Broadway house, downtown in Soho.
Downtown in Soho, you exactly.
How long were you there?
I bopped around Circle for about 2 years. I did one of their plays, Amulets Against the Dragon Forces, with Paul Zindel. I mean, he was the writer. I was a part of their workshop for about 2 years, and I was just blessed to, you know, be a part of that company. I think some things that may have happened before that, eventually, I got Yale Rep.
Also performed the Rep.
Mm-hmm. Yes, did a play there.
In New Haven.
In New Haven. Walter Dallas directed a play called Peel Hill by Samuel Kelly. And it was about young men in Chicago. Peel Hill was an area still in Chicago where the doctors lived. So Peel Hill. And these young
P-I-L-L?
P-I-L-L, yeah.
And then Hill, two words.
Yes, Peel, H-I-L-L. And it's still there, and where the doctors live. And these guys aspired. They worked in the steel mill, but they aspired to be in this area. You know, and it's about their life. So that was one of the big turning points for me. But I guess even before that, I got a chance to. Oh, in '85, I got my equity card at the Public Theater.
Right. Yeah, you and I talked about that. So you got the SAG, AFTRA, and your equity card roughly around the same time.
Around the same time.
Back then it was about $800 or so.
Yes.
Now it's about close to $3,000.
That's what I heard.
Yeah.
So glad I got in.
You got in early.
When it felt like that was a lot of money then, probably, for me, obviously. But
that was a lot of money then.
No $3,000.
That's right. So, and then I was trying to have you sort of explain the 300 odd productions. A lot of them were productions that ran for about, some were one-nighters that you did just a show for one night. Some were workshops that you ran for a few days, a weekend, or more. And then others were 2 weeks, and still others were a little longer. So that's how you racked up that many productions. And you're probably, later you were probably doing, when you did television work, you were in a number of what they used to call horse operas, or
soap operas.
Another thing, but you did that. You did a number of those, and then you also did some film work. You were in a dozen films.
Film work, television series. Oz.
You want to mention some of the names?
Yeah. Oz as Travis Smith in Oz. I did at least 12 Law and Orders.
Just a little louder, sort of breaking here.
Yeah.
So Oz, which is a really well regarded.
Yeah.
HBO's. By David Simon, right? That by David Simon, the writer?
There were several writers.
The Wire by David Simon.
Yeah, several. Okay. But it was pre-Wire. A lot of the guys who were in Oz went over to The Wire.
Yeah, Oz is well regarded.
Yes. So,
and then which other ones?
I was Derek Fry on All My Children. And I did several other roles in All My Children. Anywhere from, you know, policemen, judges, things of that sort. Young men that was a part of some of the new characters' lives and things like that. A bunch of all the New York stuff, Third Watch, New York Undercover. I had some
about 12 episodes of
I did
12
two
episodes of Law and Order.
Yes, I did two episodes of New York Undercover, one with Jeffrey Wright, who you spoke about earlier, Ray Arana, who was originally opposite James Earl Jones in Fences on Broadway, but Malik Yoba being one of the stars of New York Undercover. And it was like, it was the series that you wanted to be in at the time.
That's right. The character you mentioned just briefly, he was in Fences. I saw the original Fences on Broadway. What part did he play? Because with Vance Courtney, he was the son of Fences, and James Earl Jones played the father.
Yeah.
So what part did he have?
The
person you mentioned who was in Fences with James Earl Jones. You just mentioned somebody.
Ray Arana played, he played Troy's sidekick, Bono.
Okay.
Yeah, Bono.
And you know the actor who later played the sidekick in some other versions of Fences. What's his name? The heavyset. Older guy. Denzel. Here was the name.
Oh, you're talking about Steve McKinley Henderson. Yeah.
Denzel played the father.
Yeah, Denzel played Troy, and Steve McKinley Henderson played Bono.
Yeah.
I did.
He's another Wilson.
He's a Wilsonian. I did Jitney
right.
with Steve McKinley.
That's right.
Yes, he's a Wilsonian.
I think he's upstate. He's based upstate.
Yes, I think he teaches at one of the colleges upstate.
Right.
I think it's SUNY somewhere, maybe upstate.
So there's a whole sort of alumni of Wilson actors and actresses, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and what would be considered those Wilsonian soldiers are those who were around when he was actually alive and writing. We were doing Seven Guitars in Chicago, Val Davis, Rita Santelmo, Hudson, myself. August was still writing these plays. So the Wilson.
So you're there early. I've been blessed
enough to be a part of them.
Yeah.
So you got a list of Larry Fishburne, Angela Bassett, Samuel Hayes.
Was Lawrence Fishburne?
Yes, he was Sterling and Two Trains Running.
Okay.
Uh-huh. And
why don't you just mention, if you will, please, the four or five productions you were in on Broadway.
Oh,
August Wilson's production.
I was only on in two on Broadway, Jitney and Seven Guitars.
Yes. And you've acted in all 10 of the plays.
I directed stage readings in Augusta in all 9 of them, but one of them, Radio Golf, was still on Broadway, so we couldn't do it. We didn't have the rights to it.
And of course, you knew August Wilson. You met him.
Oh yeah, knew August. Got. You know, things that he would give the cast, books, and
that must have been, you must consider yourself quite, you know, fortunate to have been able to act in this place,
so fortunate.
To know his work,
so fortunate,
and to clearly know the value of his writing.
Yes, the value of his writing, what it means, what it's going to mean for generations to generate
going forward. Yes.
Just so honored to have known him. Signed my copy of Seven Guitars personally to me as being the guy who originated Floyd Martin, in that play. Just incredible, wonderful time. During that time, I was so blessed to be a part of it because that was coming along. You wanted to be in an August Wilson play. You
right.
just wanted to be
yeah,
in
of course.
Not just because it was going to Broadway,
no,
but
because the language.
Yeah.
I mean, the writing was
yes.
so extraordinary.
Yes.
Classics professor said that language and that dialogue goes back to the Greek tragedians, you know. You hear that in Sophocles, you hear that in, Euripides, you hear that in tones of Shakespeare. Just extraordinary.
You can't make it up. You can't make it up. If you got a monologue, you might as well learn the monologue so you can be in the rhythm of the monologue. Because if you try to make it up, you get lost, confused.
And all of those 10 plays that he wrote before he died at the age of 60 is now a Broadway house named after him. This was last 10 or dozen years or so.
Yes,
the August Wilson Theater.
Yes.
And West 48th or West 49th Street.
Yes.
Yeah.
One of them.
Right, exactly.
Probably West 49th.
Yeah. Just extraordinary.
Mm-hmm.
And to think that he died at 60 in 2005.
Like that, shocked the theater world. Obviously, shocked so many actors, but shocked the theater world.
He really did. You know why? Because he emerged in the early 80s. You know, so thank goodness we had him for what, about 25 years or so?
25 years, yeah. Of putting shows on Broadway and writing.
And he just came out of seemingly nowhere, but he had done the work.
Yeah,
he had, you know, he'd done a lot of workshops and was mentored by the great Lloyd.
Lloyd Richards.
Lloyd Richards of Yale Drama School at Yale.
Now his plays, his first play was accepted at the Eugene O'Neill Theater Conference in Waterford, Connecticut. And I understand that he had submitted his plays to the Eugene O'Neill 8 times. And that's 8 years.
That's rejected.
Before they said, okay, we'll give you a shot. And Lloyd brought him up, I think, for Ma Rainey, Black Bottom. And he continued to come up up into Seven Guitars. But then after that, Lloyd was no longer the artistic director. They were no longer going through that channel to get to Broadway. And but yeah, they were developed, the first five were developed there.
So tell me, just looking at the arc of your career, it's actually just quite very interesting.
I kept getting out there, kept getting up in the morning. I kept dressing up, kept getting out there to get, you know, to do whatever I could do. Thank God I'm still in the game, still getting on base. The best is yet to come.
There's a Chinese proverb goes, the 1,000-mile journey begins with the first step. So you just made that first step and you just kept going.
Yeah, I kept going.
Kept opening up. And it really proves that we always talk about that. It's a Marty's. As long as you stay in, if you can stay in the game and keep flying your trade, things will open up. So, the two Wilson plays on Broadway you did. Any other productions on Broadway?
And I did American Son with Kerry Washington, directed by Kenny Leon.
That was recent years.
That was 2019.
Okay.
And then I did Stick Fly, written by Lydia Diamond and directed by Kenny Leon.
So those were the two other productions.
That's
two.
So four on Broadway.
Right. So far.
Yeah, so far.
And there'll probably be a fifth coming.
We'll find out
this fall, now that we know Broadway's opening up on 14th September 2021. And then a lot of television work.
Of
course, the soaps, soap operas,
the episodics,
that's right.
The television series. I did something with Engineer Smith a couple of years ago called, I think it was something like A Lifetime in the Streets. It was dedicated to the Freddie Gray situation, uproar in Baltimore.
The killing of Freddie Gray
in Baltimore. Now, she is a one-woman show, but I was a part of the team of voices that were around her singing some of the gospel songs and things of that sort. So it was an honor to be a part of that, and that was televised.
So even that, so even dramatic production of film.
Yes.
Yeah. Theatrical.
And the film work, I'm actually on hold for two films now, Papa's Pain and I Am Charlie, Mariska Phillips and Papa's Pain, Derek Anthony. And so we're waiting on this whole COVID thing and everything that goes along with that to say, time to go.
A lot of filming has started back.
A lot of things have started. You know, COVID restrictions had kind of upped the ante, particularly for independent filmmakers. It costs a little bit more to hire someone to take the temperature and get everybody vaccinated. And
follow all of the CDC guidelines.
All of that. Have a doctor on set. All of that. So a lot of that is being released a little bit. Most people are vaccinated, so. But in the beginning, one of the reasons why we couldn't go into production last year with the film that I'm on set to do really soon is because a lot of that wasn't in place. And to get it in place would have caused a lot more money. And we're working towards it. And now it just looks like it'll be in a matter of months, I would say.
Let's talk if you don't mind, about something off-Broadway and off-Broadway. Can you talk about some of the productions that you've been in off-Broadway, and then smaller houses, the off-Broadway.
Off-Broadway.
And then, of course, you've done a lot of regional theater. You did Shakespeare at the Oregon Shakespeare Festival
here. Yeah. Well, let's start with
you did King Lear.
Did King Lear at the Classic Theater of Harlem, and did Macbeth at San Diego's Old Globe. did Richard III at the Art and Shakespeare Festival of Comedy of Errors.
Right.
At the Art
Richard III.
You did. Yeah.
One of the sets that we call the Henriette plays. That's the first set of Henriette plays.
Yes.
H-E-N-R-I-A-D. So that they're about Henry V. And then the second one is
Comedy of Errors.
Uh-huh.
Now the first one is Richard III, and then the Comedy of Errors.
Yeah, I was talking about the sets of Henry plays about King Henry by Shakespeare. So you have one, three set plays, and then you have the others, King Henry, the six parts. Parts one and two, and then Richard II, and then part the second. So I divide them.
So, yeah, but some of the, what I would say, some of the off-Broadway companies that position themselves as a standout, say Ernie McClintock's production of Equus. Ernie McClintock is out of Harlem. He's originally from Chicago, and eventually went to Richmond Hall and started the Jazz Actors. I was a part of the company that presented Equus, Dream on Monkey Mountain, and Raising in the Sun. Raising in the Sun had a young Tupac Shakur, who was about 9 years old, who played Travis. So I was a part of that company.
You're saying that one of the Raising in the Sun productions, Tupac was in it?
Yes, off-Broadway in the Harlem area, by directed by Ernie McClintock.
I was, people talk about African hip hop, but Tupac comes from two interesting strands of black life. One is sort of, revolutionary kind of Africanist side, his mother and her activity, Panthers and others.
Yeah.
And there was people in the family that certainly were even part of the black power movement that actually took up arms.
Yes, yes.
Was coming from Africa, I think.
Yeah. I don't know the direct history, but I know his mom was a Black Panther. And she
had a mid block, Black Liberation Army. Sorry.
Yeah, yeah. Allowed him to be active in the arts community.
I know. It was so wonderful. Yeah. I mean, they started in what? Delaware or Baltimore, right? Tupac.
Well, Tupac was born in Harlem, and then he went to Baltimore.
Yeah.
Yes, he went to Baltimore.
Because they were Will Smith's wife.
Yeah, that's when he met Jada Pinkett.
I just wish that he could have that arts, lost them so early, and I thought he was just,
the films he did, you can tell, he was just so present, just present. Because when you've been indoctrinated into theater and you know it, then once you get out there, you can kind of see that this person had done some theater. So it came out in this film, the kind of work that he did as an actor. So, of course, I said...
So he was like 9 years old in that production?
Yeah.
In Harlem. What was the production again? Raising the Sun.
That's Ernie McClintock's 127th Street Rec Ensemble, the African American Studio.
That was probably up the block from Harriet Tubman School, Grammar School.
Where is that?
127th Street.
Yeah. You okay?
How long did that 127th Street Ensemble?
They started before I came to New York. They started about 1970. I was a part of it starting around 1980. And I think somewhere along the line it became the African American Studio, African American Studio, but it started out as the 127th Street Repertory Yard Song.
Do you know Preston is amazing? None of these productions, a lot of these production companies, stage companies don't exist.
They don't exist.
I'm talking about the ones in the black community.
Yeah,
a lot of them don't exist.
A lot of them are. Yeah.
And the ones that are still there, they're just a shadow of themselves.
Around that time, it was Frank Sinatra's, Roger Furman, I did a play about Sam Cooke at her theater.
Are you talking about the National Black Theater?
No, she was the first African American cab driver in New York, female cab driver. What's it?
She had a theater company.
Yes, she had a theater company. She was in the original Shaft, and she gave back to the community.
Well, you were in Shaft too, the remake.
I was in the remake.
Yeah,
but you were in the remake
30 years later.
Without a doubt.
So we're going through again the arc and the trajectory of your career in theater. you were mentioning some of the other off-Broadway and off-Broadway houses, and then some of the regional theater productions.
Yes. I get a few more off-Broadway houses in. We must bring in Woody King's New Federal Theater.
Great. Woody King.
Yes. Did Joe Turner's Come and Gone there. Did my third August Wilson play there. Playing Loomis and Joe Turner's Come and Gone. August came to see that. I think that was the 20th.
I saw that on Broadway.
Oh, okay. You saw Delroy Lindo on Broadway?
Yeah. Delroy Lindo, right? Uh-huh. Jamaican actor.
Mm-hmm. Well, I did Urban Transition Loose Blossoms with Chadwick Boseman. And Sade Litvak, who's the artistic director now of the National Black Theater, took over her mom, Barbara Ann Tears.
That's right. She,
so, also the Billie Holiday Theater
in Brooklyn.
I started out way back in 82 with The Trials and Tribulations of Booker T. Stanley Brown. Me and an actress, we were the ingenues in our 20s. Phyllis Yvonne Stickney was a part
Comedian.
Of that.
Yes. Comedian
as well.
And an actress.
Yeah. And so we did, I did that and a few others plays. Went away for a while, did a lot of regional theater for a while.
So tell us some of the places where you did. You were at the Arden Shakespeare Festival.
I was Old Globe in San Diego. I was at Confesses at the Denver Center in Denver, Colorado. Did Split Second with Ella Joyce, you know, from Rock, Karen Charles Dutton. We did Split Second, and that was in the Birmingham Theater, Detroit. Oh boy, I've done so much regional theater. We did Jitney with Stephen King Henderson, Anthony Chisholm in Atlanta, at the Alliance Theater in Atlanta. The Arden Theater and in Philadelphia. Also in Philadelphia Theater Company, did Hill Hill there.
Did Crossroads.
Also,
did
Crossroads as well. Yeah, my first play in Crossroads was Jitney. And then we did Autumn by Richard Wesley at Crossroads.
Great black playwright.
Yes.
Lives.
Yeah, yes. Still alive. Still teaching at NYU.
Right.
It eventually went to...
also wrote movies.
Yeah.
But I like what you're doing. Continue rattling off that because it's important that people know some of these regional,
fine regional theater companies. Oh my God, I've done just about in every major, I've done at least four regional companies in Philadelphia. I did a workshop under the direction of Tay Diggs.
Did you ever do anything at the MacArthur Theater?
MacArthur Theater?
In Princeton, New Jersey.
I don't think I've ever done the MacArthur Theater.
Okay.
I've done a play there. Yeah, they were one of the main plays. Emily Mann, I believe, was the artistic director there.
Now tell us how many roles. How many Shakespearean roles did you play?
I've done about maybe six or seven, you know, in plays.
You were Kent and
King Lear. Andre de Shields was Lear. That was at least 15 years ago.
Yeah. Fine. New classics. Theater that focuses on classic, plays from the Shakespearean canon. Mm-hmm. Black Theater Company.
Oh, yeah.
Classical Theater Company. Classical Theater Company of Harlem.
Yes, no less. Yeah. Classical Theater of Harlem. They produced that.
Yeah.
That was the only play I've done with Classical Theater of Harlem.
Yeah. And you were in Richard III as well.
I was in Richard III at the Arden Shakespeare Festival. Mr. Al Bundy, who is artistic director at the Yale School of Rep, was the director. Comedy of Errors, set in the Harlem Renaissance. Kit Gash, the director. And that incredible production at Arden Shakespeare Festival. Got my equity card with Kit Gash at the New York Public Theater.
I don't know how you remember all the productions. I mean, aside from being an oral historian, I'm also an executive producer and director of institutional advancement, which is a fancy term for it.
It's so many.
I can't even remember, and I've been involved in 50 productions of just a small number of years, and I can't remember all of them, so I don't know how you remember. Because your tally is large. It probably borders 380 distinct productions and workshops and readings that you've been in. So that's, mine is about 50 now, just local, regional, community theater. So I don't know how you remember.
Yeah.
Your resume will certainly be as long as the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Well, you know, every once in a while.
And more alive than the Dead Sea Scrolls.
Well, you know, every once in a while, you have to cut off some, you know, some theater and add the more recent ones.
Yeah.
So I actually wrote a play on Jimi Hendrix.
Right.
We did at the New American Sports Cafe. Rome Neal directed me in that one-man show of Jimi Hendrix. We went to Amsterdam, to Bed Amsterdam, and Rotterdam, and Tielsberg in Holland.
We did three cities in Holland, in the Netherlands.
And two of the members of the Jimi Hendrix Experience was a part of that. Well, one of the members of Jimi Hendrix Band of Just was Buddy Miles. And then...
the lady. Yeah.
And then Buddy Miles.
Yeah,
and then Noah Reddy was a part of the Jimi Hendrix Experience. And other musicians from Europe and the United States were a part of that tour as well. That was in 1999.
That must have been a lot of fun.
That was incredible. It was a lot of fun. It's where
long,
I was
how
at
long
that
was
time.
How long were you in the Netherlands?
We went there for a week.
And
a week.
You did three cities in a
week? Yeah. And we would go in and do you know, a night here, a night there, because really it was music, you know. And they brought me in to, you know, do kind of a theatrical production of Hendrix. But it was all people playing Jimi Hendrix music.
So the two countries you've worked in Europe are the UK and the Netherlands.
And the Netherlands, yes.
Right.
Yes.
It's been fun working in Europe, right?
I love it.
State funded.
Yes. I hope I can add more, you know. I would love to go to Rome, Paris, and all those, you know, areas with theater productions.
Right.
But at least I went to, I got there to those places, yeah.
Right. Now, I wanted to get back to the Circle Rep. You said the Circle, it wasn't the Solo Rep. It was the
Circle Rep.
Yeah. And you did one production with them, Downtown Manhattan.
Yes.
They were in Soho as well? Or were they on 50th Street?
They were in Soho. As a matter of fact, they were on Broadway around Houston. Yeah, that's one of them. And then they moved over to 6th Avenue around Prince.
Okay.
Yeah. So yeah, they moved over there. Yeah. So
and then just briefly, you also did a year of us working with some productions, sort of with a local theater, community theater, regional, in London.
In London.
Well, you studied there.
Yeah, I studied
at Lambda.
Yeah, I studied at Lambda. Yeah.
We joke about this. Not RADA, not Royal Academy of Dramatic Arts, but
Lambda.
Lambda.
Their rivals.
Yes.
Yes. RADA, Lambda.
Yes.
But so that was studying.
Yeah.
And we did our.
Did you enjoy your time there?
I enjoyed it. I enjoyed London. I wanted to go to London.
Second home
for
me.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Wanted to go to London.
Second home.
Yeah, that's great. Awesome. Where did you stay in London?
When I'm in London, I keep going back and forth London for a long time.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm in Holborn.
Oh, you know what? Well, I don't know why I said that, because I don't know a lot of places.
And then Hampstead.
Okay, gotcha.
Yeah. Very nice.
Yeah. Well,
area.
Yeah, well, we had the curriculum there in Earl's Court and Funwell Road. I understand that, which means now.
Earl's Court by the convention. So the convention center.
Yeah.
And event space. Yeah.
Yeah. And then they took us around. We went to Oxford, what they call Oxford, you know, of course, and went to Stratford-on-the-Avon, you know, went there. Saw the castles, Warwick Castle, and things like that.
Did you visit the Globe as well?
Yes, I went to the Globe. I just went there to see it. But I went to the National Theater. I saw Ian McKellen and Richard III. I saw... Roger Reese, I believe, was in another play at the Barbican Theater. And we saw three productions of the Royal Shakespeare Company and Stratford-on-the-Avon.
Now, what I meant to ask you, what were your parents? What line of work were they in?
My mom, my dad, I really never knew my dad. Louis Bates Jr., I'll say his name. I never really knew him. My mom and him were separated when I was barely probably 1 year old. And most recently began to meet his other children. And that's been a beautiful thing. That's only happened in the last month. So really getting to know them. But my mom worked in hospital administration. And my mom, she wasn't excited about me going into acting, but she wanted to support me. So she supported me. And she was born in Augusta, and she came to Newark, brought me up here when she was like in her 20s. And we lived in Atlanta, of course, and then she came back to Newark. And that's eventually where she died in 1999. But she was in hospital administration.
Were you the only child?
I was the only child up until 19, and I have a sister when I was 19. She lives in Jersey. Her name, we call her Nene. Her name is Lorelia. Lorelia Brown Phillips. She has two children. My mom, I was only child most of my life. My mom, she's taking me around. Got a little boy, she's taking around, trying to make, you know, things happen here and there.
But I mean, you did well. I mean, you were able to start, you know, working as a professional actor.
Yeah.
Not too soon after. And you were able to sustain yourself.
Bumping, grinding, you know, like I said, didn't come out of the Yales or the Juilliards or any of those schools. Kind of bumping and grinding to, you were able to get to a level of, you know, you mentioned you want to do Broadway and things of that sort. You want to do television and film.
Do you find yourself having to do any side jobs?
Yeah. I did a lot of market research jobs, and I did bellman work at the Holiday Inn Crown Plaza.
That's well paid.
At the Macklow Hotel.
Yeah.
Essex House, where I got a chance to know Miles Davis. Who was living upstairs. I saw a bunch of people there, but the bellman, I was always saying the bellman make more money than anybody.
I did a bellhop job after my freshman year this summer in Columbia. Great hotel, doesn't exist anymore. Later became a Swiss hotel. It was on Park Avenue, 56.
I made
a lot of money in the summer working as a bellhop. Yeah. Now that hotel in Central Park South, which is where the Essex House was.
Yeah.
Donny Hathaway, the great singer.
That's where he fell
out of the window.
I've been to that room. Yeah. Fell out on probably.
That happened.
Yeah.
That was around 78, 79.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. Fell out on one of the generators for, you know, air conditioning. And
such an extraordinary figure. We're winding this down. You and I can go on for about 2 hours. We're off screen, we've already gone on. But we're going to stretch this a bit and go for another 10 minutes. Because I wanted you to get into talking about, I mean, it's such a well-trodden area when you look at, again, all of the things and the productions you've been involved with. Stage, film, and include audio. So you want to tell us a little about the audio?
I'm doing an audio right now, a Nutcracker for Marvel. I'm getting ready to, you know, they're just a kind of subsidiary that's presenting it. I've done a few audio things, you know, voiceovers for audio, voiceovers for commercials and things.
So you've done commercials and
I just covered
the waterfront.
Yes, sir, man. I have a commercial agent and I have a legit agent. And, some of them have it all in one house, but not all of them. But I was fortunate enough to have a commercial agent and I have a legit agent.
So they're probably a voiceover agent too.
They're within the commercial agent.
By the way, if you're doing voiceovers, they have to be a member of the union.
Yes. And that's really good money, and it's really fun work to do these, you know, these cartoon characters or their audio books, which I haven't had a chance to do yet.
And you've been a New Yorker for a long time. I mean, now you're in Manhattan, the other side. So you're a New Yorker?
For the most part, I've lived in New York probably longer than any place I've lived. But you know, like I was saying, I also left New York to live in Oregon for 2 years. I lived in Maryland for a year. I was in Denver for a year, and my work has always been across the country.
Sure.
And you know, one thing I think maybe just a little missing from this is the fact that for 20 years, I had another focus, not necessarily by design, but by destiny. I was called into the ministry. And I studied, went to seminary and worked with a church.
What denomination?
It's a non-denominational church in Brooklyn, New York. And
Big one.
It's, you mean a big church?
Yeah, there's a big non-denomination.
Okay.
There's several.
There are several non-denominational churches. It's a rather medium church, New Genesis Christian Center in Brooklyn, New York. And
I
it's in New East New York, around Atlantic and Shepherd area of New York City. And started out around where BAM is, on Ashland, between Cab and Fulton.
They started there and then they moved to New York.
And then they moved into that area.
Because that area around BAM is so...
So it's totally different now than it was then. There's a Pulaski Shakespeare Theater across the street.
That's right.
BAM is in all that area.
You got your Whole Foods, once Whole Foods come in.
Everything over there is amazing. Yeah.
So you went to seminary?
It was a seminary, New Genesis Seminary. We had teachers that came from another Bible seminary out of Boston and came into our church to teach and take us through some of your course.
You went through a seminary program?
Four years.
And then you were ordained?
Yeah, I was ordained. Yeah. So I've done weddings and funerals and counseling and all
of
that.
So that's where you regularly are on Sundays?
Sundays, that's my shot. As a matter of fact, I have a Zoom meeting tonight when I leave here.
The Wednesday night prayer meeting.
We have those too.
Yeah.
Tonight we're having a meeting because we generally have a ministry.
That's wonderful to hear. I didn't know that.
That balanced a lot of things out for me. And if anything, I would say to young people that are desiring to go into this business, it's a business where I always say we love it, but it doesn't necessarily love us, because it will replace us with somebody who looks just like us. It's a small door that so many people are trying to get into, and it will test you whether or not you really want to do it, whether you really want to do it. It will test you. It will test you. It will take you through trials and tribulations. But if you have something to call on that will open those doors for you, that will make a way for you in a really impossible situation. We're talking about even now African-American actors are dealing with even not the competition, but in a way you have African actors and you have actors from the UK and the African-American actors. Actors of color trying to get into that door.
Right, so now they have a bigger pool of people. More bigger pool is that the same role that we go to, let's say, African-American actors now?
Yeah.
Yeah,
and if I'm speaking to anyone out there, I'm not just trying to categorize you, because then all actors are trying to get into this door, trying to get into this small door. And if you look at the lineage and the time of people that have made it and have stayed with it, only a few have been able to get through it and have made it. Viola Davis said it even better. The actress, she said, there are some people who just want to be famous. And then there are some people who love the work, and they embrace the work and put the work into the work. And you need, by the will of God, something came into my life to open some doors. I didn't call on it. I didn't want it. I didn't say, hey, I need it. But it came into my life, and it made the difference to just my longevity in the business.
And that's what struck me.
Yeah.
And I knew it's interesting to find out. I mean, what you said is so sound. And to see where the source came from. This faith.
The faith, the tenacity to stand there. Oh man, of course, there's several times. There's times I came and sat in this park. And after auditions. And barely had a sandwich to eat.
This very park, I don't doubt it.
Barely had a sandwich to eat. Hoping that I would get a role, my commercial agent was originally down here on
Park Avenue South.
Yeah,
or near
Park Avenue South, around 14th, 15th, 17th Street. you know, and now they've moved up to Broadway. So I was in this area quite a bit, and there used to be an incredible famous restaurant. It was a Brazilian restaurant. Now it's the Chase Bank.
Well, no, the Chase Bank was the coffee shop. Remember the coffee shop was a
yeah,
lounge?
Yeah, yeah.
It was a lounge. Chase Bank.
Yeah. And it probably eventually became a coffee shop, but one time it was a Brazilian restaurant and a bar. Yeah.
Before the coffee shop.
And
we were talking about it the other week, last week, I think.
Yeah.
So faith has always largely been in the Christian church?
Yes, sir.
Oh,
yes,
wow. Sir. Okay. So it wasn't something that just came out.
You know, I grew up in the church, but you know, just more because my grandmother made me go, and my mom said you should go, and I went, and I could do plays in the church.
Right. And as you got older, did you still?
When I went to college, I wasn't thinking about a church. But there was a minister who was the dean of students who called me out and said he wanted me and a friend of mine, Maurice Preston, to start a children's theater. And
the other Preston told me about.
Yes,
he started working with me.
Yes. And he was the reverend at the church, and he would ask me to come up and read scripture. And I said, oh, okay, I'll come. Since you said so.
Well, you probably knew it too, because you grew up in the church, so you know, conversing.
But I wasn't interested. I went because I appreciated him, and he called me to do something like that. And yes, I'll go do it.
Well, so you did have this epiphany then, like 25 years ago, you went back to the church.
In college, I was giving opportunities, you know, to read scripture in the church. I did it because they asked me. Eventually, I would get mail from Yale Divinity School. And I was like, never mind. I'm not interested in being a minister. I don't want to do that. You know, so, but it was
Divinity, Yale Divinity. So many, seminaries.
But it was a part of my life. The places I've directed, most recently, The Man in Room 306 at the Lunar Stage, one-man show about Dr. Martin Luther King. That's probably, and we did August Wilson and Religion at the Billie Holiday Theater.
So, the room 306, it's four numbers, it was three numbers. It was in that room in Memphis, Tennessee.
Memphis, Tennessee.
That's where he was killed.
Yes.
He was staying in that room, he was killed just on the balcony.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, I did that.
That motel is now a museum.
Yes, it is. Yes. Yeah.
So that's a play that you wrote?
I directed it in 2018 at the Lunar Stage Theater in West Orange, New Jersey. I also directed August Wilson and Religion at the Billie Holiday Theater, part of her summer program there at the Restoration Plaza.
Was that August Wilson and Religion, was it dealing with spirituality in August Wilson's play?
What it was, I was given the opportunity to take some of the spiritual elements of August Wilson, what he had written, made specific Bible references in his plays. Yeah. And I took them all and I created a story out of it and got a group of actors and presented it. And we had a series. We had August Wilson and Women, August Wilson and Children, August Wilson and Religion. And I was asked to do August Wilson and Religion.
Preston, just as we've, time has evaporated, and we could go on, because your story and then this new dimension that you told about the spiritual aspect of your life and how it profoundly impacts life. Are you pastor in the church now?
I'm an elder now. At one time I was a co-pastor, but once I began to even work even more, couldn't always be on the grounds of the church, I'm an elder. In the last couple of years, I've been pretty much close to the church because nothing's, there's, and I mean, we're online with these services.
Absolutely.
But I've been putting a lot of, you know, time and work there, and it's been rewarding. Without God in my life, without faith, I just would have stopped a long time ago.
You know, yeah, I think that you know what you're saying is just remarkable. As we come to a close, tell us what is your, we know that you were in this production of Great Brother Broadway, previous to March of 2020, just before this, you know, pandemic shut down the whole planet. So that may be coming forward. And then, are you working on some things?
Yeah, I have, like I said, two films, Papa's Pain, based on a, at least I sent it to you, HBO short that I did some years ago, another one called I Am Charlie, about a young woman who's a detective. And I've written a play called Augusta Brown. It's about a blues guitar player who's a blind man eventually, and he quits the blues to become a full-time pastor. And then there's a...
It's based on a true story?
No, but it's based on a lot of stories I've heard, and then my own imagination. You know, there was Reverend Gary Davis, who was an incredible guitar player. And they discovered him in Harlem after being an incredible guitar player in the 40s. And then you got Son House, the incredible blues player, who's also, they call the blues and the preacher.
You know how many people left the stage, film, and even television, you know, for the faith.
For the faith, yeah.
For
Sister
faith.
Rosetta Tharpe.
That's right, yeah. One of the greatest guitarists.
Yeah.
And then, in as recently as the early 70s, get Christy Love, this unbelievable black actress, beautiful. She left a very good show. Do you remember that, Christy?
Yeah, I remember.
She left and became a Jehovah's Witness. And it just continues. Before that, there are a number of
the brother who also was in Sanford's Son, played the son, Devon Wilson, maybe?
Right. Devon Wilson.
He's a full-time pastor.
Yeah. And then, of course, the great Ethel Waters, later in years, joined the Billy Graham Crusade.
Yes.
So there you go. We're about to close out right now. So just tell us what we can look to see you and Jerome Preston Bates.
Okay, Jerome Preston Bates.
I'll always keep saying
that's
James.
All right. The first review I got in the first review I ever got in a paper. I was so excited about it, and it was in the Village Voice, and they called me.
I think they called me Jerome Preston Jones.
Maybe because they were thinking of the great actor, yeah. You know, James Earl Jones. They were thinking he has a voice.
Well, you know, look forward to me continually to do the work I love, but most importantly, inspiring people of all colors and races and children to believe in themselves, have faith in the gift that God has given them, because your gift will make room for you. Be very encouraged and be very confident of this one thing, that he that has begun a good work in you is still able to perform it. I used to think that I was giving it up and going somewhere, giving up my art and going to preach. My pastor always told me, no, God just want to use you. So I'm grateful that God is still using me as an artist. But I wouldn't have never been able to stand here today if I had not been chosen and had faith to believe God and serve God and minister to God.
Through your artistic creativity and what you're doing and building this wonderful, beloved community that, as Dr. King was saying, we all are working towards. For New Millennium Oral History Archives, we want to thank Jerome Preston Bates for taking the time out and really just blessing us with the narrative of his life and his work and the work you're doing as a pastor as well and much else. So we thank you very much for taking the time out.
I am so honored to have this opportunity to talk to you about the work that has inspired me. And I've been inspired to talk to you.
We thank you very much.